Come on. Come on, you have to be there somewhere.
FM, what are you doing?
I'm looking into the future of the X-Men movies to see if they can fix their continuity.
Well, I didn't know you could do that, FM. So what's the verdict?
I've got nothing.
What's up, family? Fallen Marvel here, and X-Men Apocalypse has come, and now today we are going to talk about it. The movie already has people split down the middle. Is it good? Is it bad? Is it a franchise killer? Who knows, but we are here to talk about it today.
Of course, we know X-Men Origins Wolverine was a true franchise killer, but somehow it got saved.
Yeah, Marv, you're right about that, but anyway, as usual, I'm going to give you the good, the bad, my personal insights, and later on the video there will be some light spoiler talk. I'm keeping the spoiler talk separate from the rest of the review just in case you guys still haven't seen the movie yet, you still plan to, and I will let you know when the light spoiler talk will start. So I'm just bringing it up because there's some things I just want to talk about a little bit more in depth instead of making just a whole big long spoiler video.
Thank goodness, FM, nobody wants to see your spoiler talk go into these long sagas.
Yeah, thanks for stating the obvious, Marv. Anyway, like I said, I'll let you know when the spoiler talk begins, so let's go ahead and get into this review. So the movie begins introducing Apocalypse in ancient Egypt, and I think that this first part of the movie does a pretty good job at setting the tone for all the events that's to come in the rest of the movie. It really seems that they are doing their best to try to push the limit as much as they possibly can for a movie that's PG-13. Needless to say, some pretty nasty stuff happens to some people in this movie. Again, this is setting up Apocalypse's character, and it's set in ancient Egypt, and they're showing this whole ritual thing that he's got going on, which I'm still was a little confused about, but we'll get to that in the latter part of the video.
FM, I can just see you're just itching to talk about this stuff.
Yeah, Marv, you got me, but I will be patient. I will wait till we get there. As many questions as I have, I think it does a good job at setting up the story for Apocalypse and for all the other events that's going to take place in the movie. So I could say I don't have much of a problem with that. Now, the things I really wasn't worried about going into the movies were the acting. So, of course, from James McAvoy and Michael Fassbender, they still brought their A game. And the acting, for the most part, from the supporting cast was pretty good too. So there weren't much complaints there. Hands down, the most effective thing about this movie was the introduction to Magneto with his family. And no, this is not spoiler talk because they mentioned his family in the trailer, so it's safe. During those scenes, you really see the emotional attachment that he has, and just him trying to find his way essentially after all the stuff took place in Days of Futures Past. And I really thought that aspect of the movie really made you care about his character. Now, what I found really peculiar about this movie is that the way they set it up in the trailers, you would have thought that Jennifer Lawrence's Mystique was going to have like a majority of screen time in this movie. For the most part, she was still a key character, but it wasn't them using her to 100% propel the story like they did in Days of Futures Past.
So Fox kind of broke their most popular actor trend a little bit.
Yeah, just a little. I mean, she still had a significant role, but it wasn't to the point where it started overshadowing everybody else other than Wolverine. And speaking of Wolverine,
yes, we know he's there. Your Wolverine is in the movie.
Yes, he does show up. And one of the concerns I had with them featuring Wolverine, especially after the last trailer, I really thought this was going to be a scene that was just going to be just extra gratuitous and really just didn't really have that much effect. But for the most part, it was still a good scene. Remember earlier when I said the movie pretty much set the tone of pushing as far as they can with a PG-13 rating? Well, they definitely did with the Wolverine scene.
I guess somewhat setting up the prelude to the rated R Wolverine movie that we're supposed to get.
Yeah, I guess so, but we still gotta wait and see how that comes out. Another thing I can't complain about are the special effects. I mean, one thing about most of the X-Men movies that we've gotten, that the special effects have never been short of pretty awesome. I mean, some of the effects were a little questionable here and there. I'm thinking the where they really shine was anything that involved Quicksilver, essentially. And just like in Days of Futures Past, they pretty much let Quicksilver steal the show. As overpowered as I think they've made Quicksilver's base power, I can't deny that the scenes involving him are good.
You didn't see that coming?
Of course I saw it All right, I see what you did there, Marv. The introduction to some of the supporting cast was actually good. I liked Psylocke's look. I liked Angel's look for the most part. Nightcrawler looked cool. I had no problem with Jean Grey. I mean, she wouldn't be what I would expect as far as a Jean Grey type, but for what she did in that role, I thought she did pretty decent. Alexandria Shipp as Storm did better than I thought she originally would, because I've always had my reservations as far as the movie Storm goes with Halle Berry.
FM, how dare you talk about Halle Berry like that?
Marv, you don't want to go there with me. You truly don't. As I was saying, Alexandria was decent as Storm. You kind of bought into her character a bit, and just for the most part, I mean, she was fine. Now, a lot of us were concerned about how Apocalypse looked in the movie early on, but for the most part, he still looked okay. I wasn't really too thrilled about his design, but for what it was, I still think it was all right. Another thing about Apocalypse I did like was how his voice would change whenever he raised his voice for any reason. Like, he had like this really somewhat menacing tone. He talked normally, but once he rose his voice, it's like it warped. Like, he was basically speaking with like two or three different voices. So I thought that aspect of him was interesting, and it at least made him very threatening. So as far as positive, that's pretty much all I got for the movie. So without any further ado, let's go ahead and get into the next section of the review. Some of the supporting cast introductions were kind of abrupt. Like, they never really eased into it. They just kind of just plopped you right there. And even though it was nice to see them, it was still just like, like, it's kind of like they were just, it's like they're kind of shoehorning them in their own movie, which I think is a little weird. One of the main problems I had at the beginning of the movie was I felt that some of the scenes, the way they were edited together, just seemed like they were really disjointed. They go from one scene and they finish it out, and then they go to like two or three other scenes, but then come back to that earlier scene like they just left off from that. And it just felt like really strange. Like, it was like, wait a minute, is it like a chunk of time been taken from here? It's like they spent like one or two days like doing that same task. It was like,
maybe the other stuff was just happening at the same time. They just went back to it.
Yeah, Marv, on paper that sounds like it'll work, but when you're actually watching a movie, it kind of takes you out of that moment. And while we're still on the subject of the supporting cast, another problem I've had is the lack of development of these characters. It's not to say that they didn't try to develop them, but it still left a lot of room for improvement as far as developing them as characters. I mean, Xavier still gets his development, Magneto still gets his development, Mystique still gets her development, and I guess Apocalypse gets his development, but it's not really so much as a development as opposed to him just, you know, trying to set things in motion. But other than that, it's just they focus so much on the people that we've already established that essentially they still forgot about the people who are still new blood. It's really no fault of their own, but it's definitely something that should have been improved on during the production of this movie.
Well, at least Psylocke got more screen time this time around.
Yeah, she did, from the only 3 seconds she had in X-Men Last Stand. God, that was funny. I honestly didn't know Psylocke was in X-Men The Last Stand until like 2 years ago, and that's sad. It just really wasn't paced too well. It just really kind of felt like, it kind of felt like a jigsaw puzzle. And anytime you watch a movie and like things are kind of like just spread all over like that, sometimes it's a problem. And unfortunately, that pretty much makes up the first half or so of the movie. The rest of the movie does get better, but it's one of those situations where it still leaves more questions than answers as far as how certain things are resolved between certain actions and certain characters, but kind of is what it is. You just kind of have to just take it as is.
All these flavors and you choose to be salty.
Salt has nothing to do with it, Marv, so get over yourself.
You mad, bro?
Find my center. So as far as my insights go, as a whole, the movie is all right. It's not necessarily great. Would I call it a franchise killer? No, but I do feel it took a step back from Days of Futures Past.
So Marv, are you ready to talk about the spoiler stuff now? Because you seem like you're about to blow your top.
Okay, yes. So at this point in the video, if you do not want to spoil it, I suggest that you stop now and skip to X amount of time that I will put on here once that's all determined. Now, when it concerns Apocalypse, one of the things that they never explain is the whole origin of the whole transferring his consciousness from one person to the other using this thing that was on top of a pyramid that when sunlight hits it, it's supposed to start this whole process of him transferring his consciousness from one body to another with all the knowledge of these mutant powers that he's transferred. All that's still intact. Where does the source of this come from? Like, how is this working exactly? And it's one of those things that's just left as is. He's acquired all of these mutant abilities, and the last one that he took over in the beginning of the movie is somebody who apparently can't die. Like, he obviously he has this mutant that has this super healing factor of sorts. So basically what happens is that he gets buried because you had some rebels that saw Apocalypse as a false god, and they sacrificed themselves and basically buried a pyramid under ground, and he wakes up like thousands and thousands of years later. In the movie, they finally confirm that Alex Summers and Scott Summers are brothers, which I had to assume they had to acknowledge at some point. And on top of that, they kill him off. So yeah, Havoc dies.
Yep, he wasn't the only one that died, did he?
Yeah, unfortunately, Angel dies in the movie as well, which I thought kind of sucked. Angel was a character I think was completely underdeveloped in this movie. Like, he literally had no real character development. He was just there to be the next horseman, you know, and, you know, that was pretty much all she wrote. He was basically just there. And going back to Apocalypse, apparently he has this ability to where by touching a mutant, he can enhance their powers. He can augment other mutants' powers by simply touching them. That's how he creates his horsemen. And I'll get to something in a little bit, but I'm just throwing that out there for right now. The next thing I want to talk about is the Wolverine scene. Now, I was afraid that this was going to be something that was going to come off really cheesy just for the sake of, you know, for some fan service. But I have to say that probably ended up being the best scene in the movie. Now, even with that being said, the issue that I have with it is the overall setup for it. Like, Wolverine essentially got maybe 3 or 4 minutes of screen time or significance in this part, and that's exactly what it was there for. It literally didn't have anything to do with propelling the story as far as Apocalypse goes. It was essentially a scene completely to set up Wolverine. There was even this really insignificant little scene that they threw in there. It really just felt so out of place. It shows Scott, Jean, and a couple other characters coming out of the movie theater from seeing Return of the Jedi, and they kind of go into this whole conversation about which one was better, and then they just had to throw in that one line. Well, it was like everybody knows that the third movie is always the worst. And it's like, okay, like that's just their way of trying to appease fans, acknowledge that X-Men Last Stand was bad. But at the end of it, like, it was like, was it really necessary for, did we need this scene? That was it. Like, it just went on to some other plot devices or whatever, and it just, that was it. It was just done. So the last thing I want to talk about before I conclude this video is the main issue that I have is the continuity. Like, at this point with these X-Men movies, there's really no point in asking for comic book accuracy when they tell these stories. They've essentially been all over the place since their inception. So at that point, you just have to take it as is. But when a movie has a problem following its own continuity, that's when it gets somewhat to be bothersome, when they are essentially their own source material. Example. Let's go back to X-Men First Class. There was a scene when Xavier used Cerebro for the first time, and that was the first time he had connected with so many people. And if you notice, while he's connecting with people, you see certain key characters while they were younger. One of them being Storm. As you can see, Storm is younger, and she has white hair. Anybody who knows anything about Storm knows that she was born with white hair. Look at X-Men Apocalypse. See something different? I picked up on this when I watched the trailer. And as subtle as it might be somewhat, the thing is that they still have chosen to ignore any type of rich history with Storm. And the thing is, with her having a natural white hair color, that's something that was a part of her heritage. And it was a very interesting story that they could build on to build her character up, and they still chose to ignore it. And instead of doing that, they just had Apocalypse give her the white hair. You think that's the only one? No, let's go back and look at it again. See, here you see a little boy with shades on in the middle of the day. Who else could that have been? Yet Scott in Apocalypse is already in high school and just experiencing his power, so he didn't even need any shades yet. So it's just the really lack of just paying attention to your own continuity. To me, it's just astounding. I'm going to say this really quick before I give my score, because a lot of people have been making this mistake. The events of X-Men First Class still happen. Days of Futures Past events only affected from the 1970s going forward. So everything that happened before that, all that still happened.
There you go, people. Everything undone by a little nitpicking.
Call it what you want. That was my observation of how they pretty much neglected their own continuity, okay? So, with all that being said, after much deliberation on this movie, X-Men Apocalypse gets a marvelous score of 6 out of 10. If you take the movie for what it is, any personal gripes aside, the movie was just okay. It wasn't the greatest. It's certainly not the worst. Would I consider it a franchise killer? No, I don't think so. But what I will say is that in comparison, I do feel that this movie was a step backward from what they did with Days of Future Past. And even Days of Future Past kind of had its own issue, but for the most part, it was still a mostly good movie. So, you know, at some point, I gotta give credit where it's due.
We can all agree X-Men Origins Wolverine was still the worst.
Yep, I concur. So guys, that's pretty much it for this review. Let me know what you thought of this movie, if you'd already seen it, or whatever expectations you may have for it. Who knows? Whatever you're thinking, put it in the comment section. So as usual, go ahead, like, subscribe, and all those wonderful things. I'll check with you guys later. Until then, you keep following my advice to go nerd, but nerd responsibly. This is your boy, Fallen Marvel.
And I am the X-Marv.
And family, we are out.